Welcome into our PNC Roundtable on Newstalk 760 WJR.com. It's a pleasure to be with you and to once again welcome my co-host, Rick DeVore, Regional President of PNC Bank. It's a great time to be in Detroit, isn't it, Rick?
Oh, it's a great time. I've already been out shopping this morning, Paul.
Have you really? For cars?
Well, we're looking around. I have my personal tour guide with me, Mike Wall. He's helping me.
Yeah, well, it doesn't hurt to have Mike Wall, Director of Automotive Analysis at IHS Automotive, nor does it hurt to have Bill Perkins, the chairman of the North American International Auto Show 2012 edition, and we're right here on the Chrysler stand and enjoying everything that's going on. Congratulations again to you, Bill.
Paul, I'm just ecstatic. I think we have gotten off to a great start, and I just am ready to transition into industry days, which we are starting today, and everything is going very, very well.
It's going well. We had a fabulous press day. More countries represented, I think, than ever before. And more journalists, over 5,700 journalists that were here from around the world. And thankfully, for once, the first part of their story will not be about how they had to trudge through snow to get to Cobo Center.
The weather was on our side, Paul.
Nor will they say that, and when they got in, the melting snow dripped on their heads. So it's all good. It's a new Cobo Center. It's a new year. It's a new auto show, and bigger and better than ever. Let me say, Mike Wall and Rick, that sitting amongst us is the Urban Wheels Pioneer of the Year in Bill Perkins. And so we congratulate you on yet another accolade and another award. Way to go, Billy.
Thank you very much, Paul. Very proud of that award.
Well, you should be. It is a big deal. This is a big deal, too, this auto show. Show's going well this year. There are more vendors than last year.
That is correct.
Picked up Nissan, came back. What else?
Nissan, Infiniti. We had a new addition, Coda, an electric vehicle company, which really adds to what we're trying to accomplish here at the show, and that is to expose new vehicles, unveilings, electric vehicles to the public. And we've had some good additions, Paul.
Well, you sure have. I've heard nothing but positive things, and the reveals, 97% of them were for the first time international reveals of vehicles. If people don't know, that is a testament to the importance of the North American International Auto Show.
Not only a testament, Paul, but the thing that is significant about it is that those vehicles have never been seen by eyes around the world. They were unveiled right here in Detroit.
I'm afraid to ask you this question, but because it's all good and they're all highlights, but do you have some highlights, Bill Perkins, of the show? Do you? Highlights of the show?
I have a lot of highlights.
I was thinking that's a tough one. Look around you, Paul. This is the highlight. I guess, that is the highlight. And certainly the impact of the electric vehicle on this year's show, bigger than ever.
Yes, it is. I think that electric vehicles are becoming part of the mainstream, and I think that the public needs to see that, and that will be demonstrated at the show. Our partnership with Pure Michigan, we have the largest indoor ride and drive in North America, and that is indoors where people can come down, they can see, touch, and feel electric vehicles, hybrid vehicles, all type of fuel-efficient vehicles.
I notice an airiness. I notice bigger and better, broader, uncrowded displays. Do you think Cobo Center needs to expand even further for the auto show?
You know, Paul, there's a good and a bad to that. If we expanded, we could sell the space. But the one thing that we're concerned about, we do not want to lose that intimacy we have mm-hmm. with the suppliers, with the OEMs, and with the public. So, if you look at what has happened to some of the other venues in North America and around the world, they have these huge venues, but it's hard for people to actually get around and see everything that's at the show. So we kind of like the feel that we have now. So could we expand and use a little bit more space? Yes, we could. But do we need twice as much as we have now? We could sell it, but I think we would lose something by doing that.
Look, you and I have both together and separately been to shows around the world, and some of them are just too big. They're
right.
Just unwieldy. And it's not a lot of fun to go to, frankly. This one is a lot of fun to go to. You can cover all the ground upstairs and downstairs and really be blown away with it, especially this year. Now, some people are listening to WJR.com and our PNC Roundtable after the fact, but coming up while we're recording this is the charity preview. And it is such an important event, And I know that you have a lofty goal, once again, in the Detroit Auto Dealers Association, the best neighbors you can have raised millions and millions and millions of dollars for children's charities here in our area. And if it hasn't happened yet, go to charitypreview.com or NAIAS.com, buy your tickets and join us. If it has happened, you know it was a big, big success. How's that turnout looking? I know that early on we passed some numbers already.
Paul, the turnout is looking very well. It's been such a demand for tickets. We've actually had a few problems. And I want the public to know they can still go to charitypreview.com or they can go to NAIS.com or they can call 888-838-7500 and still get tickets. We still have tickets available for Friday night's charity preview. And on top of it, if they can't get through and they have a problem, we will sell tickets at the door on Friday.
Oh,
we will accommodate anyone that wants to attend charity preview.
Excellent. Well, that's only good news for the kids and the charities in our area where that money will stay. And millions and millions and millions of dollars have already gone to those children's charities. A lot of them depend on this event to have the major funding. Now, for the first time, and Rick, I want you to talk about this, obviously, Rick DeVore, the regional president, PNC Bank, our co-host for the PNC Roundtable. First time, PNC Bank is sponsoring Education Day and going to expand the range of participating students to preschoolers. This is something we've talked about before that you should be very proud of, and I know you are, the Grow Up Great program. Tell us a little bit about that in the auto show.
Well, as you know, Paul, we had a big event at the parade, and it'll continue. But really, we're focused on kind of a three-prong effort, if you will. Three events, the parade, now the North American Auto Show, and also participating with the Penske organization in the Grand Prix. This time, the first time ever, and maybe it'll be interesting for Bill and I, but we will be hosting pre-K as well as K through 12. And Bill and I will be with our friend Roy Roberts, who I know, Bill, you know very well, will be with Cookie Monster on stage. So I think I told Bill we're all going to be outclassed there by the big blue guy, but we will be hosting a week from today, actually, the 18th. And I realize this is taped, but on the 18th will be PNC Education Day.
Excellent. Well, that'll be a lot of fun, and it's very, very important. And it will be thrilling for the kids, and I think even Cookie Monster will have a very good time.
I think so.
I'm just guessing. And now it's up to Mike Wall, the Director of Automotive Analysis for IHS Automotive, not to throw a wet blanket on all this good positive talk, because I'm going to ask him what the current outlook for vehicle sales and production might be. Are we seeing any signs, obvious signs, I hope not of weakening, but signs of strengthening?
No, definitely. We're seeing, and all you have to do is really walk the hall here to see what's more to come. We're looking for actually again, continued recovery this year. We actually recently upgraded our U.S. light vehicle sales forecast from 13.3 million units to 13.5 million units. And it's a testament to the consumer, the resiliency of the consumer, the resiliency of this industry. What we went through last year with the, you know, obviously the devastating earthquake and tsunami in Japan, how that impacted us even here in the North American market, all the debt struggles, the European sovereign debt issues, the debt ceiling debate here. The consumer is still engaged. They're getting more and more engaged in the market. We're seeing that in the sales forecast as well. So it's a great time to be in the industry. We're coming through this recovery, and in an industry that is a cyclical type of industry like the auto industry is, we're on the upswing.
And Paul, if I could add, Mike Wall's forecast exactly equals our forecast at PNC, 13.5. It's interesting to note that the feel for us in January 2012 is starting to feel again maybe a little bit like May of 2011, because we all know when June hit last year, consumer confidence started eroding. I think the confluence of Europe and what was going on in Washington. But now it seems to feel again, and we're noticing in our backlog of new financings, a nice healthy recovery again. So it's feeling pretty good.
Bill, you as an owner of dealerships and with your fellow DADA owners of dealerships, you're all feeling that.
We're all feeling it, Paul, and I have to say this, 2011 was much stronger for us than 2010, but we could feel towards the end of 2011 the strength in the market. people are feeling better. The economy is giving them a little bit more confidence, and I think that some of the things that are happening are very, very positive, and as a result, people they tend to ease up a little bit and have a little bit more confidence, so they're willing to make larger purchases, and that's something that we're seeing.
Well, that's good to hear. Now, Mike did bring up, Mike Wall of IHS Automotive, the whole European debt crisis that continues. It's something that we feel pretty helpless about, but it continues to affect our economic growth. And I'm just wondering, at what point can we say, all right, we've come beyond that, or, this is going to affect the auto industry further?
Yeah, it's something we're watching very closely, and it seems like it can change, you know, in a day's notice. Things that go on in Europe, you know, between Sarkozy and Merkel and the government negotiations on the debt crisis obviously can impact us here, but we are somewhat powerless. So there is the potential for some spillover effect, but at the same time, we do believe that cooler heads will prevail over there, and they will come to an agreement that doesn't result in a meltdown of the euro region, if you will. You know, that would benefit nobody globally from that perspective. So if it does get to a sort of this semblance of an agreement amongst all of the different countries within that eurozone area, which is where it seems like it's going down that road, we should set up still actually quite positively here in the U.S.
Maybe the last international question, since we are sitting right here smack dab in the middle of the Chrysler Fiat stand, Ram, Dodge, Chrysler, Jeep, SRT, Fiat, Mopar. It's easy to read. It's right overhead. It is an international show, and so there are international influences, and all of us have heard how, for example, I may be not quoting this exactly, but to the point that without China, General Motors wouldn't be around, meaning they sold more Buicks in China than they sold anywhere else. But now we're seeing a slowdown in the China market and wondering how that will affect other markets in Asia, other markets here, and our developing markets in North America and West Europe.
This is a global industry, and more so than ever, and it can be impacted by regions around the world. China's a juggernaut out there. We're watching for the real estate market, signs of overheating there. You know, our current base case forecast is there's going to be more of a soft landing in China. Still fairly high GDP growth. Last year they did about 9%. This year we're looking at about 8% GDP growth. Not, you know, for an emerging market, that's a strong number, but not the, you know, stratospheric numbers they put out in the past. But again, no collapse. We're not expecting this hard landing in China, and that's critical for us even here in the North American market. So again, it's kind of the slow and steady. China's balancing that in their own right, and they're having to navigate this this situation as well, but we're still cautiously optimistic on that front.
And our Chinese friends listening right now at WJR.com, I have a house for sale that I can sell to you for a lot less than I paid for it. Oh, just would you monitor the website, please, to see if anything comes through?
You know, Paul, one thing I'd like to interject there. I heard this the other day, and it was very interesting to me, but because of some of the uncertainty that's going on in Europe and China, you have a lot of the manufacturers that are shifting their focus more to North America. Mm-hmm. Because we're on the mend, we're on the way up, whereas there's a lot of uncertainty overseas. So they are shifting their focus more to the North American market as far as sales are concerned, because they see more of an opportunity here than they do in Europe and China.
I'll tell you, Bill Perkins, that's good news, because if their focus is here, it's better for us. I mean, we understand the whole international thing, and we accept that and embrace it in every way that we can, but if their attention is here, that means that's where all of the advertising, the products, the good deals, and I say that reserved in a reserved way, because I don't think you need to start. You know, people say, well, whose side do you want? Why? Of course we want them to put a lot of money on the hood of the car. No, we don't want them to put a lot of money on the hood of the car, so when you buy that new car and you go home, you're out of a job because they did that. So we got to get that happy medium, and we're hoping that's the case. And suppliers seem to be doing better too, and Mike Wall, I'll call upon your expertise too there as at IHS Automotive. What's the outlook for the suppliers that you see?
Very good. When you look at North American light vehicle production, we're forecasting 13.8 million units of light vehicle production this year versus roughly 13 million units last year. Continued growth, steady growth, you know, nothing too untoward in terms of heady growth rates, but again, 800,000 units incrementally. We don't want it to grow too fast, because suppliers are still coming through this recession and rebuilding their own capacity and rebuilding their, really their cost structure. So, but with that said, you know, again, 13.8 million units. I know a lot of suppliers that are capacitized or have a fixed cost structure at a lower break-even point. They can absolutely make money on this. So if you think back to the old days when we were doing maybe 15, 16 million units of production, suppliers were struggling to get by. They were barely break-even. We've gone through a lot of that. It's actually setting up for a very profitable scenario for suppliers and automakers alike.
Well, I tell you, the outlook looks very rosy at this point. I know, Rick, you see it for the Detroit 3, and I'm wondering if we're getting closer and closer to being able to call them the big three again. Seems to me we are.
I think we're getting close, and I think the issue that I think all of us know is out there is I think there's going to be good coexistence between the supplier side and the big three. You know, in the past, you know, then things got really good and the suppliers kind of got jammed. Getting back to Mike's point, you know, not making money at 15 and a half is pretty ludicrous. And now I think with legacy costs changed in not only the big three but also suppliers, people are making pretty good profits at these lower numbers. And so hopefully we can keep that good coexistence. And
it seemed to many of us, and I won't speak for any of you, because let me be the one that gets in trouble, but it seems that here we are rolling along in what was a very difficult time, and we're really starting to see some light at the end of the tunnel, not the proverbial speeding train coming right at us, and we're going like this. And all of a sudden we got smacked with these CAFE requirements, and they're pretty substantial. And I'm just wondering, with the looming CAFE requirements, what that's going to do to the industry. From your level, you're going to have to depend on primarily Chevrolet as a fine Chevrolet dealer, but General Motors to be able to provide the vehicles to you through this seamlessly and without having to put on what had been threatened to be by all the auto companies, an incredible price tag on a vehicle to achieve what they're asking us to achieve.
You know, that's the fear we have, Paul. Anytime you have standards that are set that high, it's going to add cost to the vehicle. And, you know, we're in a market, a very sensitive market right now. You know, a lot of the jobs out there and the people that we serve they're not making the money that they used to make. You know, and as a result, they can't buy as much automobile as they used to buy. So now you turn around and you put a restriction like this miles per gallon thing on them, and you raise the price of the car $1,500 to $2,000. It's going to put a lot of the vehicles out of reach for people, and that's the thing that we don't want to see.
I just felt the timing was just couldn't have been worse. Is kind of the way I look at it. But we'll see what happens through all of that, and wondering, Mike Wall, what you see as these looming CAFE requirements and your clients.
It's going to be a challenge. What we're seeing, and we're seeing it when you walk the show, the technology that's on display, it's going to be all about technology, hybrids, electric vehicles, but not just the typical green-type vehicles. It's going to be more direct injection, turbocharging and supercharging, and lightweighting, taking weight out of the car. And that's an opportunity, actually, for suppliers, any supplier that can pull weight out of the vehicle. But these are tall orders, particularly the 2025 metric, which is, I think, 54.5 miles per gallon. To get to that level, you're going to see more electrification in the vehicle, more hybrids, and that is more cost. And it's going to be a challenge, and we're going to have to navigate that. The 2016 number, you know, I think we're going to be able to get to that largely with a lot of the technology we have, but it is more costly technology. But there's a reason why, as these automakers come out and launch these new vehicles, they're showing more direct injection. They're showing smaller engines. So moving from a V8 to a six-cylinder, a six-cylinder to a four-cylinder, we're going to be seeing more and more of that as time progresses.
Well, and I hate to say it this way, but the technology has come along kind of pushed by the government, because what red-blooded American buying a pickup truck would get a six-cylinder engine a few years ago? Well, now they're selling more, for the first time ever, six-cylinder engines in those trucks, and not missing the big V8s, because the six cylinders now all of a sudden magically are putting out more horsepower. Absolutely. And getting the better fuel economy that they have. So there is a little pushing and shoving that sometimes apparently has to happen. And I'll say, Rick DeVore, we had a round table here on my morning show with some journalists, and they pointed out something that is very obvious but never occurred to me. The biggest selling vehicle in the country for a long time has been an F-50 pickup truck, yep, Ford F-150. Yep. There's not one on the floor. Right. It's the biggest selling vehicle, and there's not one on the floor here. I think that's a sign of the times and the coming times as well.
No, I think you're right. And although with that said, when you see the 150 commercials, it's pretty amazing. Getting back to your point, the horsepower and the mileage you're getting out of that six-cylinder. And I know the GM has a similar, you know, product as well. So it's,
well,
it's interesting.
And Chrysler, though people said, well, they gave them Fiat to Chrysler. Now they're going to make, well, Fiat-type small little cars, small little engines. And what led Chrysler out of the deep, dark hole and is now saving Fiat? It's like the Jeep Grand Cherokee.
Absolutely.
So it's not the vehicle they had in mind, if they had anything in mind in the government when they were doing all of this. Some of the key vehicle segments that will impact the market over the next several years.
Oh, I mean, and it's on display here. Crossover utility vehicles. You look at even the tried and true midsize car segment. You know, you look at the Ford Fusion, which was unveiled at the show, a gorgeous-looking vehicle. The Detroit 3 very much are back. They've got their mojo back in terms of vehicle design and vehicle launches. You look at the Ford Escape, for example, the new Chevy Malibu. We were at the Cadillac stand this morning. The Cadillac XTS is just a phenomenal-looking vehicle. So it's going to be the beauty of this industry, particularly in the U.S., is, you know, pick your model, you know, pick your segment, whatever you want, you will find a very capable, compelling vehicle. But it's going to be a lot about crossovers. We're also going to be seeing a movement more towards more C-segment vehicles. So think of maybe the Ford Focus, if you will, and then crossovers that are built on that segment as well. So there's a whole host of very strong and attractive vehicles out there right now.
Bill Perkins, I know you're busy as chairman of the North American International Auto Show 2012 edition with everything going on, so you might not have heard this, but when we had the Transportation Secretary, Ray LaHood, on the show right here at the stand, he said that he just bought a new Chevy Malibu. And he said he bought it because it's one of the safest vehicles on the road.
That is true.
When people come into your dealerships, are they asking you about that, about the safest cars? Are they asking you about the most fuel-efficient cars? What are they asking you on the front line there?
Paul, believe it or not, they're asking all those questions. Used to be styling was the most important factor. Now it's being shared because they are very interested in safety. They're very interested in fuel economy. And the questions about fuel economy somewhat vary depending on the price of gasoline. Mm-hmm. As the price of oil or price of gasoline rises, they tend to ask more questions and it becomes a bigger factor. As the price lowers, it's still a factor, but it's not as big a factor as it was when the price was high. But they're asking all of those questions.
Do people come in for a Volt and then decide on something else? Or do they come in for a Chevy Malibu and then decide on a Volt? How does that work?
Well,
I think of a Volt as a completely separate issue.
It's a different vehicle. We call it a halo car. And what I mean by that, it's a car that draws attention. So people come in, and they come in because they want to see it. They've heard about it. They want to see, touch, and feel it. But when it comes to buying, you know, we have so many vehicles now that we can offer that are fuel efficient, namely the Cruze. The Cruze has just been such a great addition to our lineup. Now we have the Sonic. Now we're coming with the small mini car, the Spark. I mean, Chevrolet has done an excellent job in widening their lineup of offerings to the public to meet their fuel efficiency questions and their needs.
Rick and Mike, who else is doing a good job in your view? And either walking around the show, Rick, or for you, Mike, studying these things, who else is doing a good job in regard to the product introductions that we can expect, capturing the consumer interest, the market share?
I mean, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Chrysler. When you look at the new Dodge Dart here right on the show floor, I mean, it's a very well-executed vehicle, well-designed vehicle. Hyundai Kia is another very strong player in the market. We've got some very, very compelling designs coming out of both Hyundai Kia. They're showing some continued strength in the market. It's the beauty, again, on this industry right now is we've got so much a wide variety of designs and beautiful vehicles. It's not the case of where you've got kind of the automakers you want to kind of put off in the corner. You know, they're never going to kind of, you know, perform well and have the designs. There are some beautiful designs from all the different automakers, and that's the thing. When you go through an auto show, when you go through the dealership, you're going to find some very compelling products.
I think the best product ever. And there's money available right now. I'm looking at you.
There is.
I'm looking at the banker in the crowd, my co-host, Rick DeVore from PNC Bank. There is money available. Aren't you glad you came back to Detroit? Aren't you glad you're back home here?
Well, my timing definitely has been impeccable, although I'm going to say on the air, being raised as a Ford kid, I'm going to be looking to Bill after the show to help me with maybe talking about an XTS Cadillac. So I'm maybe breaking rank here. So I'm going to probably.
I went over and looked at them. Absolutely beautiful. The Continental now, MKZ or S or S, MKZ, S, which whatever it is. Beautiful. The new Cadillac, a completely brand new car to go, obviously, right up against a 3 Series or 5 Series BMW. I mean, there's no question about that. And it looks like it really can. Even if they poo-poo it, that's at their own risk, I think.
You know, Paul, I have to add this because being chairman of the show, I think it demonstrates the competitive environment that we're going to be facing in 2012. All of the manufacturers are doing an excellent job in producing new, designing new products and bringing fuel-efficient product offerings to the market. And I think it's just it just demonstrates how important a show like this is, because someone can come to this show and they can see it all. Whereas if they try to do this on their own, it's going to take an awful lot of time.
Take a lot of time and money going from place to place. This is a great place to be able to see these vehicles. And you know, with that thought in mind, Rick DeVore, the headline earlier in the week from the Detroit News, scrappy automakers take pot shots at rivals. You know, there was a period of time, and Bill, you certainly know this, but Rick, there was a period of time when everybody was going through these painful times, so nobody really took shots at anybody because we were that kind of shared misery. We're coming out of that, and the competitive juices are flowing big time, which, again, is good for those of us who would like to buy a vehicle.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, to me, it's not as much about the foreigns have gone down. I think that the domestics have gone up, and now it seems like it's just one-on-one, very matched vehicles, styles, efficiency. And I think that's what all the excitement to me is about. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, we were talking earlier about Cobo Hall, and as you know, there has been a large budget for renovation, and we're one of three banks that did finance that. So we have more than a casual interest, Bill, in this going well, and that deal closed at the end of last year.
See, now he's taking credit because it turned out really good.
Absolutely.
But if we were if we were sitting here right now and a drip just fell on my head, we had nothing to do with this.
But, Paul, I want him to know how much we appreciate his participation in that.
Why is everyone talking through me? You're here together.
Well, you're the host.
Yeah, I guess. Well, I'm the co-host, but it is good to see that, and it is good that you guys stepped forward. And there was a time when banks weren't able to step forward. There was a whole bunch of confusion. It cost us with our homes and with our cars and with anything. And hopefully, now that all those New York bankers and New York Wall Street guys who screwed us up in the first place have all been paid back. I thought I'd better say that.
Notice I'm not touching that.
No, because you had nothing.
We're not a New York bank.
No, I know that. And the local and the regional banks didn't cause this trouble. And unfortunately, you were caught in the fallout of it, but it wasn't. It was a few people on Wall Street that were all – they ran us into the ground, and then they were hired to bring us out. So, you know, they made money going both ways. Don't even get me started on that.
Which has always been the case, though, Paul.
Yeah, but this time it was really bad because it affected everybody and everything. Okay, that's behind us as far as I know. I guess I go then to Mike because this is what he does for a living. Mike Wall of IHS Automotive. The key growth technologies in automotive over the next 5 to 10 years, this is what you do, this is what you study. The outlook for electric vehicles versus hybrids versus other powertrain technologies over the next 5 to 10 years. There are those who say, though diesel hasn't played a big role here, it has to and it will in the United States. What do you say?
Well, we're going to see much more of a democratization of technology. You're going to see, and you see it in the show right now, as these new vehicles launch, you're going to see an option for a hybrid. You're going to see an option maybe for a plug-in hybrid. You're going to see more and more, again, of that direct injection technology, turbochargers and superchargers. The adoption rates are going to go through the roof. Now, electric vehicles and hybrids, as we see it, it's going to take a little more time to get into a higher adoption rates on those because of the cost. There still is a very big cost penalty on hybrids and electric vehicles, but it's growing. And we're going to see it grow further as it's launched on other vehicles. So, again, the outlook is actually quite strong. And From a technology perspective, there's a lot of opportunity.
Entering its 24th year as an international event, the North American International Auto Show, among the most prestigious auto shows in the world, providing unparalleled access to the automotive products, people, and ideas that matter most, up close and in one place. We do hope that you will come to this show and enjoy it. If it's before the charity preview on Friday the 13th, buy your tickets. Join us at the charity preview. Go to charitypreview.com, NAIAS.com, or call 888-838-7500, 888-838-7500, or even have permission from the chairman himself saying, just show up at the door and we'll sell you tickets there. Otherwise, come to the show and enjoy it. It is all of those things. That is one of the most prestigious auto shows in the world because of leadership like yours, Bill Perkins. And we salute you both with your Urban Wheels Pioneer of the Year Award and as chairman of this incredible North American International Auto Show 2012 edition. Congratulations to you, Bill.
Thank you, Paul.
We thank you, too, Mike Wall, for bringing your expertise as Director of Automotive Analysis at IHS Automotive. We do appreciate that experience and appreciate you being here with us.
You bet. Thank you.
And the final word comes from my co-host, Rick DeVore of PNC Bank. Just an overall view on this thing and the importance, again, and we're thrilled that that you're playing such an important role, and especially with your Grow Up Great program for the kids and the involvement that you show in the community on a regular basis.
Well, we're excited about the show. Again, it is a barometer for the economy. It always amazes me how quickly it comes right after the holidays. What I'm looking for from Bill is a weather forecast for the charity preview, because there's a lot of women with open-toe shoes that are Chuck Gatick.
There he is. Playing.
Excited.
He's playing to the women. You gotta love him for that.
Chuck put out a pretty dismal forecast, I think, last night.
Did he really? I know there's going to be a little snow, but nothing like the old days that Bill and I remember.
I don't think it'll be freezing cold. I think we'll have some precipitation.
What would it be without it, right?
As Alan Mulally said, it'll be really pretty with a little dusting
festive,
of snow.
Yeah.
But I have to tell you, the atmosphere is going to be so festive. It'll be nice, warm, and cozy in Cobo Hall for the charity preview.
I'm looking forward to it, as I'm sure you are.
Absolutely.
We'll be right here.
Are you kidding?
I guess you'll
we'll
be right here. Court right here.
We'll be cutting the ribbon wherever that will be. We'll be down there in the hall cutting the ribbon, then come right over here for a special broadcast from 6:30 till 8 p.m. on Friday the 13th. And if you're hearing this after Friday the 13th, first of all, you'll know how we did on the weather forecast. And the rest of it is, come to the show if the show is still on. And it should be still on. So it's on for the public Saturday, January 14th through Sunday, January 22nd. It's bigger. It's better than ever. And we thank Mike Wall, Director of Automotive Analysis at IHS Automotive, Bill Perkins, chairman of this great show, the North American International Auto Show 2012 edition, and, of course, our co-host, Rick DeVore, the regional president of PNC Bank. You go on out, make it a great rest of the day. Regards, Paul W. Smith.